Good afternoon, and welcome back to another episode of A Likeable Science here on ThinkTech Hawaii. I'm your host, Ethan Allen. With me today in the ThinkTech studios is Ray Tsuchiyama, if I got that right.
That's correct, Ethan. I'm glad to be here talking on science, technology, innovation with you, because those are very vital topics for the state of Hawaii and our society.
Exactly. But they're not only vital, they're likable, too. They should be fun. They should be celebrated. They should be enjoyed by everyone, right? I mean, people should enjoy doing science. People shouldn't be scared of it, right?
Well, I think you're correct, that there's a disconnect between people who are top scientists, as if they're not real ordinary people.
Right.
And another disconnect, that these people can't be from the state of Hawaii.
Right.
They can't be from Kalihipalama,
right.
Or they can't be from Nanakuli or Waianae.
Right.
And so I think that's a greater service that you're doing, is to make science fun.
Yeah.
And accessible to everybody, that it does play a major role in our lives, but they're achieved by ordinary people.
Yeah, and I mean, it's increasing. So day by day, there's more and more things where we are being asked to make evidence-based decisions on the course of our country, the course of our state, the course of our individual lives. And without some background in science, how do you make those decisions? It's truly frightening how I think the state of sort of science literacy in this country, actually, and in the state.
Yeah, well, you're correct that these waves of focusing on science and technology in our history, the last one was the great Sputnik scare by Russia in the late 50s, and that sparked a race for to get into putting an astronaut around the Earth, and then later on, the great goal by President Kennedy to send a manned spacecraft and then land on the moon, which is unbelievable, stating that in 1960-61, and it was achieved in 1969, barely 8 years afterwards. So if you do have an objective based on science and engineering, you could achieve that.
Right, indeed. I mean, the Human Genome Project, that was achieved basically on time and on schedule. They really did it. They did it when they said they'd do it, and found surprising things from it in terms of the human genome has many fewer genes than we thought. As yet, the fallout from that is unclear. People are really only now starting to mine that information in a really serious way and beginning to make use of it. But there's no reason. A lot of that work was done by people just like you, just like me, just like our viewers out there, right?
Well, I think you have a very good point. And people see also the commercial applications or products that they can use in their lives. And lots of innovations and products came out of the research at NASA, for example.
Sure.
The advances in computing could not have happened without the great coding that people did back then. There was a movie on some programmers, African-American female programmers who contributed to this project. I always think of a product that people use every day in the kitchen, and it was based on some scientific experiments in the material science department at MIT in the 20s, and it was very simple. At what level or how thin can they make a metal? And that was the objective of the research, and we use aluminum foil every day.
Exactly. These things that start out as abstract phenomena end up being commonplace, and yet, I mean, you do see, and that's actually a nice example, that the thinness of substance, it gets into an area that you wanted to talk about a little bit. I know nanoscale science, and how properties of substances change at the nanoscale, right? And that's one of the hallmarks of it, is when you get something small enough, it behaves rather differently than it does in bulk properties. But trying to convey that to sort of the man on the street is sometimes a challenging thing.
Well, I think you're correct. In science, the questions are, you know, what is the universe? What is an atom? These are questions that people spend lifetimes and even more trying to focus on. Engineering, on the other hand, is how to solve problems, provide a solution to retaining water by a dam, for example, in civil engineering. And they have big issues right now in California California because of the rain. So, but going back to your question, last week a major figure passed away at MIT, Professor Emerita Mildred Dresselhaus.
Right.
And she focused on carbon, which is a very, it's everywhere on the planet, as you know, even in our pencils, for example, and diamonds are made of carbon. Right. And she looked at, you know, how small carbon could be and how to deliver things like, and or make it into tubes or buccarines, fullerenes, you know, properties of carbon. And they could be delivery agents for medicine, for example, within a human being, body.
Yeah, so Jay and I were just talking on a recent show about graphene, right? And the single sheet of atoms in graphite. And that's now apparently being a very hot topic for being able to put pores of just controlled sizes into graphene sheets. And it, again, one of our big defense companies has actually apparently perfected this, or at least gotten some version of it that will allow you to convert fresh water to salt water at about 1% of the current pressure needed for reverse osmosis, because they use those ultra-thin membranes now, a membrane of graphene, basically, with special pores in it.
That's so fantastic, yeah. And I think you're also shedding light on one of the issues in our society is to sustain the budget for scientific research, because you don't know where it's going to go. You really don't. And unless you allow young people and young scientists and researchers to go into other fields, you know, or their own projects, they may come up with things that we had no idea would exist in our that could really make our lives better.
Right, but it's so much, and you see this in really top-notch scientists. They're playful people. They really are. They're thoroughly immersed and enjoying what they're doing every day. They don't regard it as some sort of rote work. It's a job I've got to go to. And yet, so much of basic science is routinely taught as this sort of rote work. You know, memorize this list of terms, learn this vocabulary list. You know, and it shouldn't be that way. It should be all about playing. And there's so much stuff out there. I mean, again, going back to the nanoscale science, when you look at a puddle in a parking lot and you see that sheen on it, right? That's essentially because of the very thin layer of oil or gasoline on the water, right? And it's actually forming two layers that are close enough together that light is interfering with itself, basically, top versus bottom layer of that slick, and it's close enough that it causes interference. It's all, science is all around us every day, and there's no reason sort of to be scared of it. There's lots of questions.
I think you're also touching upon how we get more young people into science, and the value of K-12, right. Or kindergarten, within that span. If they haven't, I'll tell you a story. I was with, I worked for MIT for about 6 years, and I was with the chairperson of MIT, Paul Gray, in Japan. Mm-hmm. And we met the chairperson of Toyota. Mm-hmm. His name is Dr. Toyoda, actually. And we were having lunch, and all of a sudden, Dr. Toyoda turns to Dr. Gray and says, "Dr. Gray, how do you teach creativity?" A very interesting question out of the blue, which every country is dealing with today, not only Japan, but the U.S., and Brazil, or the U.K., or Germany, or Russia. And Paul Gray thought about it, and then he responded, you know, if a child doesn't have that when he or she enters MIT, we can't teach it.
Right, it's too late.
It's too late.
It's MIT. Like trying to learn a second language.
So K-12, the curiosity about science,
right,
and to really look for answers in the world has to be inculcated, really embedded within that being, a young person, and to learn, of course, more about physics or math or coding, whatever, at the university. But that when they get out of high school, they have to have that spark. You're correct.
Exactly. They should love learning and see themselves as a learner, as somebody who can learn, who does learn all the time, who wants to learn. And if a school has failed to do that, your school has basically failed to, your K-12 system has failed to produce what it needs to produce, right? I mean, they can produce people who know a lot of content, but if they don't enjoy learning and understanding and asking the questions,
Well, it's based on inquiry. Right. You're absolutely right. Yeah. And when you talk about the larger societal issues, I go back to Hawaii. Mm-hmm. And we were talking before the show. In 1983, I returned from working at Digital Equipment Corporation, mm-hmm. a major mini computer company of that era.
Some of us remember.
Yeah, but if 20 years from now, when mm-hmm. I meet my grandchild mm-hmm. and ask him, "How's what do you know about Google?" He'll say, "What's that?" it'll happen.
Right.
But when I returned from DEC, I joined Castle & Cooke, a Big Five land development company mm-hmm. back in the early 80s, and what we were trying to do at that point was to promote a high-tech park. Mm-hmm. And one of the ways to do that was to publish a magazine. And if you could put it, the Hawaii High-Tech Journal magazine cover, and it started out as a series of magazines that promoted scientific research at UH, and there was the Hawaii Biotechnology Group that's starting out, Intellect, a company that made a software and hardware for air defense systems was in town mm-hmm. in Honolulu. There was a sensor lab by Jim Home Kennedy at UH.
Right.
And there were all kinds of other things happening all over Hawaii
right.
in 1983.
Right. Yeah.
And the objective was to really promote Hawaii as a site, a venue for high-tech companies to come and establish more R&D facilities mm-hmm. or for entrepreneurs really to take off and establish more startups.
Right.
And so that is giving you a bit of history that I was part of a movement back in the early 80s to really get going as a society
right.
And to make science and technology a base to diversify the economy.
Right.
Now that is not new though, even
right.
in the 80s.
Right.
Going back to the 1960s, Governor John A. Burns in the mid 60s said we must have a Hawaii economy mm-hmm. based on research.
Yeah.
And that's from a time when nobody was thinking about about high tech, other than it was a Big Five agricultural dominant economy.
Right, but of course the agriculture industry itself brought in actually some very interesting technological advances for harvesting and processing foods, automation of various sorts that were quite cutting edge at the time. And of course, even going back further, as you gave me that wonderful article on Prince Kuhio and how he basically got a world-class education, what would be considered today a sort of a great MBA program, right?
That's right.
By traveling.
See, we think that we're doing the state of the art
right.
today
right.
and looking at the 21st century for Hawaii to be the Mid-Pacific center for exports, have a sustainable agricultural base, that yeah. we have great education, that have young people going out to the world and really learning more things. But back in the 19th century, King Kalakaua was really creating a cadre of young Hawaiians to go out and learn and bring back to
yeah.
Hawaii.
And it's arguable that we ought to be doing the same kind of thing again, right? We ought to be really both promoting our own resources internally, but very much developing the capacity and the capabilities of our young people to go and become citizens of the world, but bring their learning back to Hawaii, share Hawaii's learning out with the rest of the world. We should be much more thoroughly integrated into the world economy than we are, and it's very strange to me to realize when I got out here that we import something like 85% of the food we eat, and then we export something like 85% of the stuff we grow. You look at that and you say, well, who's making the money here? It's people who are transporting the goods. It doesn't seem like the way to run the state's economy.
Well, go ahead.
So why after this, you refer to this golden era in the mid-80s when everyone wanted to promote Hawaii as a technology, why did that sort of not take root? I mean, Hawaii is not thought of as a high-tech mecca these days, as it were, right?
Well, I think it has to have many groups far more. Go ahead.
I was just going to say, before we do that, I'm
told
that we need to take a break, and then we'll follow that question up when we come back. I'm your host, Ethan Allen. Ray Tsuchiyama is here with me today, and we're discussing state of science in Hawaii. We'll be right back.
Hello and aloha. My name is Raya Salter, and I am the host of Power Up Hawaii, where Hawaii comes together to figure out how we're going to work towards a clean and renewable energy future. We have exciting conversations with all kinds of stakeholders, everyone who needs to come together to talk about renewable energy, be they engineers, advocates, lawyers, utility executives, musicians, or artists, to see how we can come together to make a renewable future. Tuesdays at 1 p.m.
Aloha, my name is Richard Emery, host of Condo Insider. More than a third of Hawaii's population live in some form of association, and our show is all about educating board members and owners about their responsibilities and obligations and providing solutions for a great association. You can watch me live on Thursdays, 3 p.m. to 4 p.m. each week. Aloha.
And you're back here on Likeable Science here on ThinkTech Hawaii. I'm your host, Ethan Allen. With me today in the ThinkTech studios is Ray Tsuchiyama, and we're talking about the state of science in Hawaii. And I was asking Ray as we went into our break about why this sort of golden age of tech promotion, tech development in the early to mid 80s didn't really stick with us, why it didn't flourish, why Hawaii has not developed into a real Silicon Valley, as it were. And you were just starting to go into that.
Right. And it's not a huge brilliant answer. Because you can ask the same question in Arkansas, Montana, Idaho, or Wyoming, you know. Mm-hmm. And sometimes we think of Hawaii being so unique and so much full of talented people that we could do anything. But remember that the rest of the many other places in the world that are trying also. Mm-hmm. But going back to your question, I think there was, in order to have that diversification really flourish with startups that become larger, mm-hmm. create more jobs, and then they become, there's more startups from there and so forth. And there has to be an ecosystem, mm-hmm. first of all. It doesn't exist by itself, mm-hmm. first of all. So there has to be a program where there's research or patents or ideas coming from UH. Mm-hmm. That's our premier Carnegie One Research University, mm-hmm. here in the state. And there's a connection to the business sector, mm-hmm. that there are people who want to take those ideas to make products and license them and then employ people to, mm-hmm. further develop these products and so forth. And mm-hmm. In order to do that, you must have capital. You, right. must have venture capital, sure. to really to pay these people, right. to pay for trips to Japan or China for marketing purposes, mm-hmm. and so forth. So and also, in order to do that very well, you have to have a leadership team. Mm-hmm. In Silicon Valley or Seattle or LA or New York, it's very easy to go down the street and get a CEO, COO, CTO, CFO, CIO, and so forth, mm-hmm. to bring up, they're very experienced. Mm-hmm. And I was part of a startup in Seattle that went from zero to 100 million in about 6 years. Uh-huh. But that team was very good. And, uh-huh. so, and it was a global kind of team with very good engineering development. So, and a great product. So you have that, all those ingredients work, and then you're gone. Off. Now, having said that, 9 out of 10 startups fail,
right, sure, right.
in Silicon Valley. So you have to have numbers, right. a lot of numbers. There's that, I think, connection. Like, I'll give you an example that people don't realize. Gatorade.
Mm-hmm.
And it's a sports drink, right? And it's been around for decades.
Right.
And you think, why is it named Gatorade? Mm-hmm. It's gators,
mm-hmm.
alligators,
right.
Florida,
right.
research.
Mm-hmm.
They made it, they licensed it.
Mm-hmm.
That's why it's called Gatorade.
Right.
University of Florida.
Right.
So there's a connection there.
Mm-hmm.
And so there was something invented that became a product, and now it's going gangbusters. Right. And even if you get 10 cents out of each bottle sold, mm-hmm. wow, it adds up to real money in a few years.
Right.
So that's, again, products. But you have to have a culture of entrepreneurship.
Mm-hmm.
And when I was at MIT, everybody wanted to become an, mm-hmm. entrepreneur. And the 45% of the institute was engineering.
Mm-hmm.
And in fact, they have studies where there were more MIT graduates doing startups in Silicon Valley than Stanford.
Huh.
And it's because of numbers.
Mm-hmm.
Stanford is more like UH and Harvard in that engineering is probably 15%.
Mm-hmm.
MIT engineering is 45%. So you have a more numbers of people going out there, and they all have a vision of becoming entrepreneurs and really you know, adding value to society by making new things and creating jobs.
Right. One of my former colleagues from University of Washington went off and did a postdoc at MIT, got into one of their business accelerator programs, now has gone off and formed his own company, OptiTech, and is doing refraction of people's eyes in third world countries and much more cheaply and more effectively than anyone.
And again, that's taking an idea to the product and even adding to society in a third world country. And you're correct about another thing about accelerators, incubators and so forth. That's, again, part of that. So, and there was one called the Manoa Innovation Center that started in the mid-90s. And so, but the other thing about MIT that I want to point out is that there's leadership at the top that looks at all the work that people are doing in engineering, science, and business, so forth, and seeing how they can be put together in a new center, multidisciplinary. And I think that's something that is very unique, like the Media Lab, for example, at MIT. They were doing things about wearable computing or glasses 15 years ago. And they have centers on on laboratory for electronics. They have centers on real estate. They have all kinds of multidisciplinary centers. So it's looking at the future and having leadership that at a major university says, oh, I would like to put together software engineering and robotics and Japanese and put together a translation, you know, kiosk that would, at the airports, that would help people translate, for example.
So, for example, here now at UH, the new National Science Foundation EPSCoR program, IKIVAI, Knowledge of Water, they are bringing geophysicists together with computer modelers, basically, and a whole array of people building new kinds of sensors. They're trying to sort of model, map, and determine the extent and boundaries and volumes of the aquifers here in Hawaii, the flow rates of the water through it, and really come to understand the water in Hawaii, which is clearly of considerable interest and value to us. But that model, once they develop it, could then be applied to other islands too. So the smaller islands out in the Pacific would find that extremely useful too.
So there's a larger global market
For
something that was developed for Hawaii. And that's exactly right. So because we're an island, we don't think about the global market.
Right.
But if we can sell something, like I worked for a startup that had research based on communications for handicapped people. And that became software, mobile phones, to make predictive texting so that it would be used by people who you don't have a keyboard, right? And they're restricted in terms of access to a full keyboard on a mobile phone. And the other thing that happened, I think, in the 80s that kind of detracted Hawaii and that went into the 90s in some ways was the role of Japanese investment that came in the 80s. And that kind of defocused people on that. It was a huge tsunami of investment and money and funding. And it displaced or defocused people not to look at making companies in Hawaii and going out.
I see. So then, how do you think we can reverse this? I mean, how can we sort of reinvigorate this? Get your magazine, as it were, back on the front page. You know, get it growing again. Get that kind of
the magazine, Hawaii High Tech Journal, is kind of a historical landmark, I guess, bringing back all the things that in those magazines are obsolescent now, research. But some of the interviews by University President Albert Savone eerily is about today. Same things, innovation and venture capital and many things. I still think the number one priority for the state is public education, K-12. That is where I think so much is needed to really promote science, as you say, languages, to give children I'm not saying to teach coding, okay? I think it's a mistake to say teach coding because in 20 years, robots will be doing coding or we'll be doing something else, right? How to think, how to dream.
Yes.
I think those are two critical areas. And how to think quantitatively.
Right, yes.
Based on data, right. Empirically, based on data.
Right.
How to communicate with other people outside of your culture and language. Right. Again, another skill set there. And of course, how to dream big, right. That you can come out of Kalihipalama, Waianae, right. Kahuku, or Lihue, or Hilo, and really make a product or make an impact on a global kind of scale.
Yeah, yeah.
And so dreaming for children is, I think, we suppress that.
Yeah, that's true. Yeah. I think the school system does not encourage it.
So we have to, when children dream, we need to immediately arm them or give them ways to make that a reality in the future.
Help them learn to think about their own thinking so that they reflect on their learning. Oh, right, I figured this problem out by doing this. So that's a good strategy. Oh, that I stumbled over this problem. Maybe I should have done a different technique. Get them to think back about how they've been thinking so they can learn to think better, basically. Yeah, and at the same time, discover their own capacities for learning. Yeah.
So I still believe that the society is can diversify its economy. I'm a very optimistic person, mm-hmm. but still we have to go back and really put this in the face of every resident, of every voter here in Hawaii. Mm-hmm. Bring that back always, mm-hmm. every day. That's what's going to make that change.
Right.
And we're not going to see that change in 5 years or 10 years. It may take a much longer time, but I think also I think we have to look at Hawaii as a place that, as you mentioned before, that we can export ideas and our culture in many ways. That I think I did well in Asia Pacific, mm-hmm. dealing with people and interacting with people because I grew up in Kalihipalama. Mm-hmm. I respected people and tried to learn more about other mm-hmm. people. And because who knows where they're from,
right.
and so forth. But I wanted to get to know about them, respect them, and to communicate with them in their own way and make the dialogue successful.
Mm-hmm.
So did negotiations, China, India, Africa, Russia, you name it, I was out there. But it harks back to Kalihipalama. And so we shouldn't denigrate or make cultures that we have locally second or third class.
No, you've wrapped things up very neatly. You've called out exactly what needs to happen. It's this great idea of respect, building our own resources, doing sort of asset-based thinking, right? Realizing all the good things we have and really building from them. It's been a very exciting conversation here. I've enjoyed it. I feel like I've learned a lot. I'm sure our viewers have learned a bunch too. I wish we had more time. Perhaps I can get you back here sometime. We can talk a little further.
I would enjoy it a lot because you're a fun guy.
Well, that's what we're trying to make science.